Good morning. Lovely to be able to welcome you to worship this morning. It's great to be able to come and to worship together. Our numbers are perhaps a little bit down this morning. Is there a rally happening or something this weekend? Could you miss it? I trust you've enjoyed the rally weekend. There's been a lot of activity around Ramelton the last couple of days. It's been very busy. Happy Father's Day if you're a father. I trust you'll be treated and looked after on Father's Day. We've had Fit for Life on this last few weeks, and I just simply wanted to say a huge thank you to everybody who was involved in organizing. It was a real joint effort, I think, on people's parts, people bringing things, people organizing speakers, etc. So just a huge, huge thank you to all who were involved in that. It seemed to go very, very well. The Holiday Bible Club is coming up, starting the 10th of July. If you haven't signed up your children or young people for that yet, please do so via the church website. Also, please spread the word. This is for everybody to come, not just children or young people or church members, but for anybody. So please do pass on. I think we perhaps have leaflets in the vestibule. Take a leaflet or pass on the word, please, about that. Sunday school will be happening over the summer, but it will be a little bit different over July and August time. We're developing the theme of global disciples that we thought about in Children's Day last week, and we'll be looking at the lives of those who have gone overseas and done mission, if you like, or given their lives in service of God in various ways. And there's a video series that will be shown during Sunday school these next weeks. Also, we're hoping to have some of the young adults involved in helping. So please do bring along your children for these next summer months. Sunday school will be on. I am on leave from next Saturday for 11 days. Susan Murr is available if you do need a minister from next Saturday for those 11 days. I'm back on Thursday, the 6th of July. Robert Edwards will be taking the services next Sunday and the Sunday after. We come to worship, and we read in John's Gospel these words of Jesus. If anyone thirsts, let him come to me and drink. Everyone who believes in me, as the scripture says, out of his heart will flow rivers of living water. We stand to sing as we worship. We sing the metrical psalm, Psalm 43, verses 3 to 5. we come to read God's word together. I'm reading from Psalm 42. We're going to read Psalm 42 and Psalm 43. Page 562 in the Old Testament section of your pew Bible. Page 562 of the Old Testament. Psalm 42. This is God's word. As the deer longs for a stream of cool water, so I long for you, O God. I thirst for you, the living God. When can I go and worship in your presence? Day and night I cry, and tears are my only food. All the time my enemies ask me, where is your God? My heart breaks when I remember the past. When I stand with the crowds of the house of God and led them as they walked along, a happy crowd, singing and shouting praise to God. Why am I so sad? Why am I so troubled? I will put my hope in God. And once again, I will praise him, my Savior and my God. Here in exile, my heart is breaking, and so I turn my thoughts to him. He has sent waves of sorrow over my soul. Chaos roars at me like a flood, like waterfalls thundering down to the Jordan, from Mount Hermon and Mount Mizar. May the Lord show his constant love during the day, so that I may have a song at night, a prayer to the God of my life. To God my defender I say, why have you forgotten me? Why must I go on suffering from the cruelty of my enemies? I am crushed by their insults, as they keep on asking me, where is your God? Why am I so sad? Why am I so troubled? I will put my hope in God, and once again I will praise him, my Savior and my God. Psalm 43, O God, declare me innocent and defend my cause against the ungodly. Deliver me from lying and evil men. You are my protector. Why have you abandoned me? Why must I go on suffering from the cruelty of my enemies? Send your light and your truth. May they lead me and bring me back to Zion, your sacred hill, and to your temple where you live. Then I will go to your altar, O God. You are the source of my happiness. I will play on my harp and sing praise to you, O God, my God. Why am I so sad? Why am I so troubled? I will put my hope in God, and once again I will praise him, my Savior and my God. Amen. We give thanks to God for his word to us. And you may have noticed there, you have that verse 5 of Psalm 43. It's a repeat of verse 5 in Psalm 42 and verse 11. I think it would be the chorus as they would have sung this, which I think would have been one psalm at one point, which has been split into two. We're going to come to the Lord in prayer now. Let's pray together. Dear Lord, you are the living God. You are God Most High. And Lord, you made us. You made us in love, Lord. You dwell with us through your Spirit. You are close. In love, you sent your Son, Jesus, to die for us, that we might have life. And Lord, we come with great thanksgiving that he rose again. With great thanksgiving that death is now defeated. And Father, as we read in the psalm that we read, each day you direct your love to us. At night you are with us. Lord, in every moment you are close. And we pray to you, the God of our life. Father, we come to you with joy and with thanksgiving today. And Lord, we put our hope in you. We praise you, Lord. You are our Savior. You are our God. You are our stronghold. You are a God of light and truth. You guide us each day, Lord. You do not forget us. You listen to us when we pray. And Lord, you answer. You answer when we need you. You lift us up, Lord, when we are down. You are faithful, Lord. In every way, you are faithful. Lord, while we do not forget, Why, you, Lord, we sometimes forget you, Lord. We know that you do not forget us. But we sometimes forget you, Lord. While you are faithful, we often are not. While you love us deeply, Lord, our love for you, Lord, we confess at times it is half-hearted. Forgive us, Lord, we ask. Forgive us when we let you down. But we know that your word tells us that you are a God of great mercy. You are a God of great love. And we know that you did not even hold your son back from us, your beloved son. But you gave him up. You gave him for us. You gave him to die that we might be forgiven, that we might have life through him. Father, we thank you that Jesus died in our place so that we might be rescued, forgiven, saved. Lord, we need you. We need you, Lord. You are the only one who can make us whole, the only one who can save us. Our desire is for you, Lord. Only you can give us the satisfaction that our hearts desire. Our only hope is in you, Lord. We will praise you, Lord. You are our Savior and our God. Today, Lord, we want to give thanks for fathers, for dads. We thank you for our own dads, Lord, whether they be living or not, Lord. For all they meant to us, Lord, for the love that they showed us. We thank you for blessing us with parents, Lord, who loved us. We thank you, Father, that you are the ultimate Father who loves us so deeply. All these things we want to pray in Jesus' name. Amen. My boys and girls, Emma is going to come up and speak to you now. She's going to take our children's talk this morning. Emma, thank you.
A bit easier, you know. So, who finished school this week? Yes? Anyone next week? Nice, nice, nice. Looking forward to the holidays? Yeah. I'm sure. Look, excited for the Holiday Bible Club, more to the point. It's really good, isn't it? We're looking forward to it and we're excited. So, who are we celebrating today then? What's so special about today? Yes?
Father's Day.
Very good. And isn't it a joy that we're able to celebrate our fathers? But it's also a day to celebrate father figures. Father figures in church and father figures in maybe you play sport, or people that are looking out for you. So one day someone asked Jesus to describe who God was like, and Jesus told them a story. We would know this story as the story of the prodigal son. Have you heard of it before? Yes. But it's also known as the parable of the loving father. Can you say that for me? The parable of the loving father, yes. And in this story, the father represents God, and the two sons represent us. So when I explain this to you, I want you to think, who are you most like? Which son are you most like in this story? Now, I don't want you to tell me. I just want you to think about it, okay? So one son came to his father. He asked for his money. He asked for money to go away and spend it. Took the money. He went away. He spent it. And he wasted it, completely wasted it, okay? How do you think the loving father would have felt? Any ideas?
Annoyed.
Annoyed, yeah?
A bit disappointed.
A bit disappointed, okay. Any one more?
Sad.
Sad, yeah, sad. Lots of different feelings, right? We have to remember that this is the loving father, and this was his son. This father loved his son so much, and it broke his heart that he left. He was so sad that he had left, and he longed for him to come home. He loved him so much, and he really looked forward to him coming home. Now you can just imagine him looking down and waiting for his son to come back home again. Now, while this father, this loving father, was waiting for the son to come back, the son was out spending all the money. He decided he didn't need God. He was going to be by himself. And then what happened? the money ran out. The money ran out. He'd wasted everything, and he had absolutely nothing. Why do you think he felt when he had nothing left? What do you think?
A bit disappointed
in himself, maybe. Mm-hmm. Anyone else?
Worried.
Okay. Mm-hmm. One more. So he's left with nothing.
Sad.
Yeah. And you know, I think eventually he'd realized that he was wrong and he felt sorry. He would have felt sorry for what he'd done. And the first thought, maybe I'll go home. And the question comes to his mind, will my father accept me? Will he take me back after what I've done? And you know, sometimes in our relationship with God, it can be like that. Do you know, we know, boys and girls, well, when we sin, you know, we're wasting the good things that God has given us, the gifts that we have and the things that he provides. They're wasted when we sin. And sometimes can make us turn around and think, will God accept me? Will he take me back? And if you thought that he wouldn't, it's wrong. It's wrong because God stands with his arms open wide. When we know that we're sorry and we see that what we've done is wrong, he stands like the loving father with his arms open wide ready to have us come back again. And the life that he gives is life to the full. So full of joy. So it is. So the son heads back. He's walking back to the father, to the loving father again. What do you think the loving father did? What do you think? Any ideas? Did he go, nah, come back later? What do you think?
He forgave him.
He forgave him, you think so? So in God's word, this is where we're reading this story from, and I have the passage typed out here. I'm going to read it for you. So he got up and went to his father. But while he was still a long way off, his father saw him and was filled with compassion for him. He ran to his son, threw his arms around him and kissed him. The son said to him, Father, I have sinned against heaven and against you. I'm no longer worthy to be called your son. But the father said to his servants, Quick, bring the best robe and put it on him. Put a ring on his finger and sandals on his feet. Bring the fattened calf and kill it. Let's have a feast and celebration, for this son of mine was dead and is alive again. He was lost and now he is found. So they began to celebrate. So not only did his father welcome him and be really loving towards him, they threw a party. Church, they threw a party. Hip, hip. Ah, jeevers. They threw a party. Hip, hip.
Hooray.
Hooray! It was a celebration. It was marvelous. The loving father had welcomed his son home, and everyone was going to celebrate. Such an emotional time when you think about that. God is like the father. Father God is longing for you to come home, to come home to him. This is where you won't waste your life, but live your life, your best life. Imagine if you were invited to a party and you didn't go. Sure, that'd be wild, wouldn't it? Sure, you would go. How many sons did the father have again?
Two.
Aye, so there was one that was at the start and there was two. So the older son was at home the whole time. He never left. He stayed around the father. And maybe for you, you know, staying around the father and coming to church, being around God, knowing about him, kind of might be the same as yourself. Even though there was a party going on, and even though the son could enjoy the father's love, the older son didn't want to go inside. He didn't want to join the party. He refused to go in. What do you think the father did? So he's just welcomed this son home, really happy this son has returned home again, and now this other son refuses to come in. What do you think he did? Any idea? There you go, come here you, in you come.
Went out and asked him.
Where do we hear what the Bible says? The older brother became angry and refused to go in. So his father went out and pleaded with him. What does it mean to plead with someone?
Beg.
Yeah, really, really encourage them to come in. You really want them to come or think the way you're thinking. The loving father wanted both sons to enjoy the party, not just one. So You know, at the start I'd said to you, thinking about who, what son that you would relate to most. Now, think about that in your head, don't be telling me now. The most important thing for you to remember is that the loving father stands with his arms open wide, waiting, calling all of us home, not just boys and girls, but everyone to come to him. You don't have to waste your money, waste your life, the way that the first son did. And you don't have to refuse to come in either. When God calls us, he calls us to come as we are, as his children, so that we can put our trust in him and depend on him and ask him for the forgiveness that we see the sin that we've done wrong in our lives. He calls us in as the loving father, arms open wide, to welcome him. When you're thinking about Father's Day today, as you celebrate with your father or father figures that you have in your life, think about the call home. Think about the loving father that you have in heaven everywhere you go for the rest of your life. Join the party and come home. Come home to him. So we pray together. Let's pray. Father God, we thank you that you call us home. We thank you that you are a good father and that your love does endure forever. Lord, I thank you for the children in Ramelton. And I pray that as they finish their last week in school this week, they'll remember how much that you love them, how you sent Jesus to die on the cross for them, so that they could live free and full lives here. Lord, we thank you for your word. We thank you that it is true. And we thank you that when we open it, that you do speak. I just pray, Lord, as they go out to Sunday school, that they're able to talk about this loving Father and what a difference it makes in our lives to know that you are here. We pray all this in Jesus' name. Amen. So I was a busy bee. It's Father's Day. If you want to come around to the piano, I have some Father's Day wee thingies, you'll see it. The rule is, though, if you get one of these in your home, you're not allowed to eat the sweeties until you answer the questions on the back. Okay? That's the rule with it. Do you want to go and get them? They're over here. Enough for everyone. There you go. Welcome. Well done. Okay, you can go back to your seats.
Emma, thank you. Thank you for the work you did in preparing those wee gifts as well. Thank you. We're going to stand and sing again a hymn called Softly and Tenderly.
Thank you.
for Sunday school. Sometimes when the children go out really quickly, you think either Sunday school is really good or church is really bad, one or other. But yeah, sometimes they go out in a rush. We come to our offering now. Our offering will be received. Father, we thank you for these gifts that have been given and brought. Father, use them, bless them. We pray that you would be glorified, your name would be lifted high through what we have brought and given this morning. We pray in Jesus' name. Amen. All right. So we come to our Youth Matters slot. And in this slot, a couple of weeks ago, I told a story about a girl called Rachel who had discovered that the Bible says no to same-sex marriage, but she didn't understand the reason why. In fact, because of this, many people dismiss Christianity as not been true because of the view that it puts forth on same-sex marriage. And it's a difficult issue. It's a difficult issue. The Bible's view on same-sex attraction is very much at odds with how society has come to view this issue today. Some people think that the reason the Bible is against same-sex relationships is because it was written by hateful, self-righteous, and ignorant people. But if we read the Bible, we find that this simply isn't true. For example, Paul, the Apostle Paul, who wrote most of the New Testament, he showed great love to others. And he thought of himself as the worst of sinners. But it is, however, true to say that some Christians have treated those who are same-sex attracted hatefully. They have looked down on them with self-righteous judgment. And that, we have to say, it is not right. That is not right. And that is not what the Bible calls us to do. It is also not true to say that in New Testament times, people didn't understand same-sex attraction. It's clear that in their culture, people thought that it was okay for a man to sleep with other men. The Christian insistence that sex belongs in marriage between one woman and one man, it would have been strange back then as well, as perhaps our society sees that as increasingly strange in some ways. But the Bible says that sex and marriage isn't just about making people happy. It's actually meant to be a kind of a model for Jesus' love for the church. Now, if you've ever built a model aeroplane, you'll know that its pieces, its wings, its tail, its wheels, they match up with the pieces of a real aeroplane. Likewise, the pieces of Christian marriage match up with Jesus' love for his church. And we do see a clear difference between Christ on one hand and his church on the other. In the same way that in marriage we see a clear difference between a man and a woman. In fact, God designed human differences so that when a man and a woman come together, that they could have children together. Switching the design of marriage to two men or to two women, it's like putting, you could say, two left wings on a model plane, doesn't quite match the original. Now, there's a man called Sam Albury. He's a minister in England. He himself is same-sex attracted. And he's written a very good book entitled Is God Anti-Gay? I recommend you read that. He believes that because of the fact that he's same-sex attracted, that he's called to be single. That's his belief. And in fact, the Bible says that being single can be better than being married. Again, I would say this is a really difficult subject. And again, I would say that the Christian biblical view on same-sex attraction, it is very much countercultural. But if we want to be true to Scripture, true to the Bible, we must surely hold to the view that I have communicated to you, humbly hold to this view. We come to our prayers for others. Let us pray. Father, we want to bring to you this morning those in particular need, those who are struggling in whatever way. Lord, we think of those perhaps especially who are grieving today, Lord, those who have suffered a loss over these last days and weeks, Lord, or perhaps even longer, and are still grieving the loss of a loved one. Lord, be near to those who are mourning, that they would know your presence, that they would be comforted by knowing that you are close, that you are their sustainer. Father, we want to think of those who are in hospital, Lord, or those who have been in hospital and are recovering from that, those who are attending ongoing hospital appointments, receiving treatment, Lord. Be near to those who just are struggling with that, Lord, that they would know your strength, that they would know that you're with them, Lord, in their time of just been unwell. Father, we want to bring to you the war in Ukraine, Lord, and we mourn such an ongoing conflict, Father, and we do again come to you praying, Lord, that this conflict could begin to come to an end, Lord, to see light at the end of the tunnel, Lord, we ask. We pray you would protect life in this country, Lord. Protect your people, protect your church, Lord, that they would know your arms of protection around them, we ask. Father, we want to pray for the Holiday Bible Club, Lord. We pray, Lord, that you would be blessing the Exodus team that is preparing to come, that they would know your guiding, Lord, your wisdom as they prepare to lead us in the club for the week. Bless all the boys and girls who would come, Lord, that you would prepare their hearts to learn about you, Lord. Father, this day we want to give thanks for fathers, Lord. And we want to pray for fathers as well, Lord. Father, for all the fathers who are present, Lord, bless them that they might know your wisdom, Lord, as they seek to lead their families, Lord, as they seek to be godly examples for you. Lord, we know it can be hard being a father, Lord, so give wisdom to all who are seeking to be fathers and to glorify you in their homes. We pray for parents generally, Lord, help them and give them wisdom as they seek to bring up their children wisely. Lord, we also want to pray for the General Assembly this week, that you would bless it. We pray that you would just be helping everybody gathered, Lord, as they discuss and make decisions that affect the Presbyterian Church more widely, Lord, that they would have all they need this week. We pray, Lord, as we come to your word, that you would help us, encourage us through your word, Lord, but also guide us and challenge us as well, Lord. Help us to be striving to put your word into action this week, we pray. All this we ask in Jesus' name. Amen. Before we come to think about God's word, we're going to sing, My Heart is Filled with Thankfulness.
Love.
How often have you heard your stomach growl? Felt a little lightheaded perhaps, had an oncoming headache, and think to yourself, I'm hungry, and head to the fridge for a snack. Now, you might be surprised to learn that what can seem like hunger is actually often thirst. The truth is that many people confuse thirst and hunger. Now, clinical studies have shown that 37% of people make the mistake of confusing thirst for hunger. Therefore, there are occasions where we're heading for the fridge or for the biscuit cupboard, thinking, I'm peckish, when really what we need to be thinking is, you know, a big drink of water is what I actually need. Maybe I'm thirsty. You know, when you read facts like this, and I think it perhaps leads to another question. Are there other times when we struggle to know what we actually need, what we really need? And as I thought about this question, I thought, yes, absolutely, I think this is true. There are times when we struggle to know what we really need. Often we can get it wrong. For example, if you're feeling exhausted, what do you really need? Is it just a good night's sleep? Is it a holiday? Do you need to cut down on your working hours? Maybe there's something else making you tired. Maybe you need to go and see the doctor, who knows? It's sometimes hard to know what we really need. Also, it's not uncommon to not want to do what we really need to do. For example, an unhealthy diet can contribute to tiredness levels. So in this situation, eating healthily would be something needed, but not necessarily wanted. Let's be honest, it's a challenge to eat healthily. We can sometimes know what we really need, but we don't want to do it. In Psalm 42 and Psalm 43, we see that the writer knows what he really needs. NIV translation, as the deer pants for streams of water, so my soul pants for you, O God. Verse 2, my soul thirsts for God, for the living God. So we see that the psalmist has realized, firstly, that he has a great need. And secondly, he has realized what he needs. Or perhaps we should say who he needs. He needs God. He needs God. He doesn't make the mistake. He doesn't mistake hunger for thirst, if you like. He correctly identifies what he needs. He needs God. And the same is true for us, obviously, isn't it? We need God. But I think all too often people make the mistake of not realizing what their true need is. Now, I wonder if we ask this question, how does our culture answer the question, what do we really need? How does our culture answer that question? Now, in one word, what would the answer be to that? Perhaps more. Our Western consumerist culture would lead us to believe that to be happy, to be satisfied, what we need is more. More money, more possessions, another drink, another cigarette, whatever it may be, more. Happiness is found in what we own, what we have, what we consume. But it's a huge lie, isn't it? Money, possessions, they don't bring lasting happiness. They don't bring true contentment. But I think we can easily be deceived by this message. I think young people, especially growing up, can be sucked into this lie. They can make it their main life goal to simply earn as much money as possible. I may have told this story before, I remember in my last quantity surveying job, we had a year out student working for us. And his main goal, as he thought about his way forward in terms of work and career paths, his number one goal, in fact it was his only goal, was to make as much money as possible, and as quickly as possible at that. Now I asked him about the options that he had, and I asked him about which direction he thought would give him the most job satisfaction. And it wasn't the one that would earn him the most money, but he seemed very happy to sacrifice that, to sacrifice job satisfaction and everything else, simply to earn a lot of money and to be well off. And I think the world tells us that more equals happiness. And for young people especially, I think this is a very seductive lie. A very seductive lie. The Bible tells us what we really need is God. In God we find satisfaction, in God we find happiness. In Psalm 16 we read, "You make known to me the path of life. In your presence there is fullness of joy. At your right hand are pleasures forevermore." In God's presence is the fullness of joy. So Scripture suggests that it's been close to God that gives us joy, real pleasure. Now I think the tragedy for many is that they never learn this truth. Many go through life looking in so many other places, so many different places, for that something. For that something that they know that they need. They have a sense of need, but they never find what it is that meets that need. And even, you know, it's very possible to spend your life going to church each week and still never finding that real, intimate connection with God. A couple of things to think about in this psalm. Firstly, the psalms were used, we know, for worship in the temple in Jerusalem. Therefore, we presume that they were written by godly men, and it would have been men in that culture. We know about half the psalms were written by King David. So this psalm is written by a godly man, or we might say a believer. Secondly, we need to think about his circumstances as he wrote this psalm. Verse 3, he talks about his tears day and night. He was in great distress. He's been mocked, we learn. He's no longer able to go to the temple. He is downcast, we learn. Circumstances are tough. He says, "Why are you downcast, O my soul?" So the writer of this psalm is facing very difficult circumstances, and he's crying out to God in his trials. And I imagine this isn't an uncommon thing, perhaps for some of us, perhaps many of us, I guess. We've cried out to God amidst the great challenges of life. But you know, it's often in those moments of feeling helpless, those moments of not knowing where else to turn, that we actually realize our need of God. And perhaps one of the reasons that life includes challenges, hardships, trials, is to teach us that we need God. As humans, we can delude ourselves into thinking that we're self-sufficient, that we can deal with all that life throws at ourselves, at us on our own, that we can deal with it. But you know, we can't. Reality is we can't. We need God. What we really need is God, especially in moments of distress, moments of feeling at a complete loss. These moments can teach us that we do really need God. Moments of despair help us to learn that we do really need God. But you know, in these moments, we can reach out to God. We can seek Him. We can start to pray like we've never prayed before. But you know, even in doing this, we can still mistake our need. We can think that what we need is for God to change things, to change our circumstances, if you like, to take away the trial, to cure the illness, to mend a broken relationship. Whatever it may be, that's what we think our need is. And you know, often it's hard to understand why we do face certain trials. Life can seem unfair. And the psalmist, I think, feels this in verse 9, where he says, "I say to God, my rock, why have you forgotten me?" Things seem so bad that he feels that God has forgotten him. Verse 10, he says, "My bones suffer mortal agony." In situations like this, we can feel that what we really need is for God to change things, change our circumstances. But in this psalm, the writer doesn't really pray for that, to change his circumstances, with the possible exception that he asks that God take him back to the temple so that he can worship Him. But the reason that he wanted to go there was so that he could feel closeness with God, so that he could feel close to God again. This is what he longs to know. This is what he knows that he needs, to know God with him in his trials. So in any given moment, in any given trial, what we need is to know God with us. Not necessarily for God to change what we're going through. There was clearly a time when the writer of this psalm did know God close, when he worshipped in the temple, where in Old Testament times God's presence did dwell in a very special way. And this man had known intimacy with God. Because he had experienced this, he knew. He knew that this was what he really needed. He knew that there was no substitute for knowing God, for knowing God close to him. Now, in any trial, it's not wrong for us to pray that God will change things. Not wrong at all. But we need to be aware that it's not always God's will to change difficult circumstances. Our primary prayer in any situation should be, Lord, be with me in this. Be with us in this trial. Be with so-and-so in their trial. Draw near, Lord. May we know you close. Sustain me in my struggles. Give us strength to face what is ahead. Be with whoever is sick. May they know your presence and help. Now, verse 7 in this psalm, Psalm 42, it's a wonderful verse. The good news doesn't quite capture it. In the NIV, deep calls to deep in the roar of your waterfalls. All your waves and your breakers have swept over me. Now, the waterfalls and the waves seem to relate to the challenges, the trials that the psalmist was facing. Now, I think I may have used this illustration before, but if you've ever been up in Tranarawson Beach in the sea on a particularly windy, stormy day, and you're in the sea and you get swept off your feet by a wave, it's not nice, not pleasant at all, horrible. Now, the image in the psalm is of wave after wave crashing down on the writer. But in the midst of this awfulness, something deep down within him, something from his core, cries out to God. Deep calls to deep. So from the depths of his soul, he cries out to God. He knows that he needs God. He needs the Lord. Above everything else, he knows that he needs God. You know, we live in a world where there are advertisements all around us. People trying to manipulate us into believing that what they are selling us is what we really need. We see adverts on the TV, on our phones, on the roadside, on buildings. We hear them on the radio, even noticing some of the rally cars yesterday, advertisements on them. It's hard to avoid. Hard to avoid. And you know, we need to beware because advertisers, they're clever. They're cunning. They know our weak spots. We can be easily deceived as to what we really need. Now, as a younger man, I used to watch The Simpsons. And it's funny what sticks in your head, but there was an occasion where Homer was watching the TV, and there was like an add-on of a thing called a juice looser, which was one of those things, machines where you put oranges in, and orange juice then flows out. And in the advert, they put all these oranges in, and orange juice gushed out. Homer buys one of these juice loosers. He takes it home and he puts all the oranges in and he turns it on and one drop of orange juice comes out. You know, he was completely manipulated and lied to. You know, manufacturers are willing to spend thousands and thousands on advertising things because it works. It works. They know how to manipulate us to buy things, to convince us that we need what they're selling. And you know, 99 times out of 100, we don't need what they're selling. What we really need is God, closeness with him. Now, verse 8 is an interesting verse. By day, the Lord directs his love. At night, his song is with me, a prayer to the God of my life. The psalmist knows that God is still there. He knows that God is still working. He knows that God hasn't gone away. He knows that the Lord still loves him, but yet he still feels a disconnection with God because of the trials that he's facing. Now, a couple of weeks ago, you may remember, we looked at Psalm 139, where we learned that God is omnipresent, everywhere, always there. Yes, there are times he may feel distant, may feel far away, but he's still there. God is always there. But you know, in this psalm, there's a real note of hope. The psalmist in both verses 5, verse 11 of Psalm 42, verse 5 of Psalm 43, that repeating verse, chorus, "Why are you downcast, O my soul? Why so disturbed within me? Put your hope in the Lord, for I will yet praise him, my Savior and my God." The writer knows that his current trials, that they won't last. There's a sense of hope in this prayer. He knows that the Lord, in his time, will restore him. He will restore that sense of closeness, that sense of intimacy that he once had with him. The writer knows that the Lord will again draw near in his own time. And he will quench that thirst that he has to know the closeness again with the living God, that he will meet his greatest need. And there's a wonderful verse in the book of James. Draw near to God, and he will draw near to you. A wonderful promise. And Jesus teaches us that the way we draw near to the Father, it's through him, through Jesus. He says, "Let anyone who is thirsty come to me and drink." We read that in the call to worship at the start. So Jesus is saying that anyone who realizes that nothing in this world can meet their deepest soul need, anyone who realizes that true satisfaction is not found in more, it's not found in wealth, it's not found in material things, the deep soul need that each of us has is met only in God, only in knowing him. And Jesus also said that no one comes to the Father except through me. Now, if you've never really made a sincere commitment of faith, Jesus calls you to do that. That's the first step in knowing him and knowing your need met. He calls us to repent of our sins, to confess them, to turn from them. He calls you to believe in him, that he is the Son of God who died for your sins that we might know forgiveness. And he calls you to live for him, to know him ever more deeply, to make him the focus of your life. And you know, as we live for Christ, we come to know that deep thirst, that deep need that we have. We come to know that need met. We come to know it satisfied in a way that we have never known it before. Yes, as Christians, we will have times, like the psalmist, that God feels distant. But in those times, we should seek him. We should pray to him. We should ask him to draw close again. And you know, God in his time does draw near again. So let's not mistake thirst for hunger. Let's come to realize that what we really need is God. What we really need is God. Let's take a moment to be still just and to reflect on God's word. Lord God, we need you in everything, in difficult times, as well as good times, Lord, we need you. Father, forgive us when we seek the satisfaction that we need, Lord, in other places. Help us to be looking to you, Lord, to meet our deepest need, that soul need that we have, Lord. We pray this in Jesus' name. Amen. We close our service as we stand to sing, "I need you every hour."
Thank you.
grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, the love of God, and the fellowship of the Holy Spirit be with us all, now and evermore. Amen.